to you by Penguin.
More Than a Game, Saving Football from Itself, by Mark Gregory. Read by Rory Alexander. Preface. It is a long way, not just geographically, from the Bet365 Stadium to Wembley. Trudging out of the National Stadium on a damp Friday evening after a dull, goalless draw between England and Scotland, I did not expect the journey of this book, which began in the Potteries, would end in northwest London. Yet there I was, on the 11th of July, back in Block 140, watching England play Italy in the Euro 2020 final. Huge credit to England manager Gareth Southgate, his background staff, and the consistently impressive, on and off the pitch, playing squad, for lifting the mood of the nation. As an emotionally drained Wembley crowd came to terms with England running out of steam, I found myself reflecting how ironic it was that the national team was enjoying success only weeks after the proposed creation of a European Super League had threatened to destroy the core of English football. It was a journey that began when the FA's desire to improve the performance of the England team led them to back the breakaway Premier League. 4 decades later, the Three Lions were succeeding despite the Premier League, not because of it. The fewest national team qualified players in a domestic top division in Europe, a manager who had developed his skills primarily in international rather than domestic football, and with many members of the squad having gained valuable experience in the English Football League. And, after years of the Premier League consistently resisting calls for a meaningful mid-season break to allow England's players to be as rested as those of other countries, it was a rescheduling of fixtures due to COVID-19 that meant all countries turned up in similar shape. Fantastic experience that it was. In my opinion, Euro 2020 was only the second most important activity affecting English football in the summer of 2021. The UK government's fan-led Review of Football Governance, the FLR, which was running in parallel to the tournament, is the main event, offering a once-in-a-generation opportunity to reshape the national men's game. Having given evidence to the panel driving the process, I have no doubt they are committed to understanding what fans want. Ironically, and in complete contrast to the debate in 1992, there was no mention of the national team in the terms of reference given to the expert panel. And although I do propose ways we could improve the performance of the Three Lions, like the FLR, my priority is solving the wider problems of the men's game. I don't have the detailed knowledge to comment on the women's game, and, to be honest, it seems to be doing fine under its own steam. However, England's success at Euro 2020 is important. Firstly, it has left us in no doubt as to how crucial fans in stadiums and supporters around the country are. Secondly, the hugely impressive manager and players offer a positive contrast to the disastrous performance of the owners and administrators of the national game in recent times. We can do better. In 1990, Nessun Dorma provided the soundtrack for change in football. Today, Three Lions captures the positive sentiment towards football. Just as we shouldn't rest on our laurels with the national team, so we must grasp the opportunity offered by the FLR to create the game we want. Of course, there is no right answer. We will all have to compromise. But, for the first time, fans are at the centre of the debate. Let's bring football home. Chapter 1. What is the point of Stoke City? The Stoke City boardroom was a sombre place. It was 6 o'clock on Saturday the 16th of December 2017, and the home team had just lost 3-0 to West Ham United in a Premier League relegation six-pointer. Behind me, the West Ham owners, David Gold and David Sullivan, polite and restrained winners, were quietly sipping tea from some of Staffordshire's finest bone china. In the far corner, Stoke chairman Peter Coates and his son and vice chairman John, supporters first and owners second, were deep in conversation. With the club edging ever closer to the relegation trapdoor, their well-known loyalty and patience was being put to the test by growing pressure from supporters to sack manager Mark Hughes. That it was the former Stoke player Marko Arnautovic who had delivered such a telling blow to Hughes's tenure had undoubtedly deepened the gloom hanging over the home club's owners. The mercurial forward had been almost unplayable on the day, scoring the second goal to put the match out of Stoke's reach, a fitting epilogue to the soap opera the player had starred in since the summer. After being appointed manager in the summer of 2013, Hughes had recruited Arnautovic, the player's career having stalled at Inter Milan. The Austrian was rejuvenated in the Potteries, his performances earning him a new, lucrative contract in the summer of 2016. A year later, out of the blue, he demanded a transfer. Every supporter knows how these dramas unfold. The transfer request and the club's steadfast refusal to accept it occupy the first scene. In the second act, after attempts to change the player's mind fail, the club reluctantly allows him to leave. In the finale, the departing player uses social media to thank the club and supporters, while the money received is used to buy a new hero. The story followed the standard plotline, and the player was sold to West Ham for a reported £25 million. But events took an unexpected turn. Arnautovic ripped up the script and began to improvise. Interviewed shortly after his move, West Ham's new star questioned the level of Stoke City's ambition and claimed this, rather than money, was the reason for his move. "I wanted to join West Ham because, for me," he said, "it's a bigger club and more ambitious. We can see with the signings that we've made and the players that are already at the club." Stoke were unhappy. In July 2017, Peter Coates made his feelings clear in The Sun. "We are disappointed in him personally and the people around him. We resurrected his career. Our managers and coaches worked very hard to improve him and made him a name in the game. Last year, we spent so much effort into giving him a long-term contract, and the first thing we get in the summer, he comes back, he wants to leave." For broadcasters starved of football content in the summer close season, a full-on public spat was manna from heaven. Modern sports radio relies on sensationalism and controversy to engage its audience, so it was no surprise that TalkSport, the UK's commercial market leader in the genre, took the bait. It quickly put together a programme, What's the Point of Stoke City? And, in classic tabloid style, the presenters set out their case, that football is all about winning and nothing else matters. If mid-table stability in the Premier League was all Stoke City's owners aspired to, then they were in the wrong business. The programme's script could have been lifted from a supporter's online message board. Up and down the country, fans regularly call for their club's owners to move to the next level. It is a not particularly subtle demand for increased spending on transfers and wages to attract better players as the route to success on the pitch. Superficially, TalkSport's point seems a compelling one. After all, football is about winning. Even if we accept that talk radio is not the natural home of nuanced, rational argument, the radio station's attack was narrow and one-sided, ignoring the lessons from English football's journey to commercialisation, which accelerated in the 1980s and continued after the creation of the Premier League in 1992. The path is littered with clubs that overreached financially in pursuit of success and fell from grace. Leeds United, Portsmouth and Bolton Wanderers are just some of the highest profile examples. A strategy of win at any cost rarely ends well. Making a logical defence, though, wrongly involves accepting TalkSport's framing of the issue. Not only does it ignore the financial dangers, but just as, if not more importantly, as I know from working with football clubs, we also risk missing so much of the wider contribution made by the game. In 2014, in my role as chief economist of Ernst & Young, one of the world's leading accounting and consulting firms, my team and I began working with the Premier League to measure the competition's economic and social contribution to the UK. Football was ahead of the curve, recognising early the importance of being able to explain the sport's wider impact to a wide range of stakeholders. But over the next 5 years, we also worked with the Rugby Football Union, the English Cricket Board, the National Football League in America, and the International Cycling Union, and advised colleagues undertaking similar activities in Canada, France, Brazil, Australia, and elsewhere. Much of this work is published and easily accessible. After several months' work with the Premier League, we shared our report with journalists and the football industry at the Queen Elizabeth Conference Centre in London. After I presented our findings, the Premier League's executive chairman, Richard Scudamore, invited the then business secretary, Sajid.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.